show is great. The show is one of the best shows of all time. I mean, I used to go to these Tokyo Dome shows years ago, and this was better than any show I ever went to there. And the only thing I can compare it to is like the really great All Japan Women shows in the early 90s. Some of those shows might have been as good as this, and I'm not even sure that they were. What was awesome about this show is like there's the first part of the show, the first hour and a half, is really nothing special. It's okay. I mean, it's like just a bunch of matches that are there, and they're just okay. But from the Yuji Nagata Minoru Suzuki match, and even the tag team title match with Lance Archer and Harry Smith with Carl Anderson and Hirooki Goto was really good. But from the Yuji Nagata match, which was the next match with Minoru Suzuki, from that point on, it was as good as any wrestling show in years and years and years. I mean, it was just phenomenal. And what made it phenomenal is just that, pretty much except for one match from that point on, every match was absolutely fantastic. There was one match which was the Muto match, which I wouldn't call fantastic, but it was kind of good. But every match was completely different. The low-key Kota Ibushi Prince Devitt match was like when I watched it, that was like a match of the year. When that match was over, I couldn't believe that there could be any match better on this show. It's just like there's just no way. And I'm not sure that the Nakamura, Shinsuke Nakamura, Kazushi Sakuraba match wasn't just as good. I would almost hesitate to say better. It's completely different. I mean, one is just this incredible three way, one of the best three ways I've ever seen. I mean, like one of the two or three best three ways I've ever seen, where they're just blowing your socks off with stuff that you didn't see coming. Right after either low key works this match, he worked 90% of this match in a three piece suit, and it was only for the finish that he finally took the suit off. But he's still working in his dress shirt, dress pants, and tie. Although he is wearing martial arts gloves, which I thought was kind of hilarious with his three piece suit. But him bumping around and doing like a a match like that in the suit, I don't know why he did it. I don't know, like, who came up with the idea, but it was unbelievable, like, watching it. The Sakuraba-Nakamura match was, you know, it was like a shoot-style match, as was the Makabe-Shibata match, which preceded it. But those two matches were completely different as well. I mean, the Shibata and Makabe match was like a fight. It was awesome. The Nakamura-Sakuraba match was even better. And it was like it was like a brilliantly worked submission match. Just absolutely like a Volkan match. I mean, it was just brilliant. But with harder strikes. I mean, there were some knees in there. I mean, there's one thing I do want to say about the show. Amidst all of this stuff about how great the show was, and it was, those guys, and this goes up and down the card, those guys need to protect their heads more. I mean, it's just like there's, you know, like what we know here, it's like the world isn't a vacuum. And I mean, it's like, well, because all this research is done in the United States, doesn't count in Japan and Mexico, and Mexico's another issue, but it's the same. But there's a principle there that's similar. It's like, you know, we've learned stuff, and there's stuff that you really shouldn't do, and that's jar your head too often, and that they were doing that on this show. I mean, there weren't hard chair shots to the head, but there were a lot of hard blows to the head that they could have avoided. I mean, there was one in the Tanahashi-Okada main event where Tanahashi gives him a sling blade on the ramp, and Okada's head just, like, the back of his head hits, like, so hard. It was like, you know, you just don't want to be doing that. You know, having said that, the Tanahashi Okada match was absolutely unbelievably great. I mean, it's a match. You know, there's three match of the year candidates on this show, and I don't know if there's ever been a show where I would say that. I mean, it was really, you know, it was better than the best WrestleMania. I mean, it had the WrestleMania feel, but better matches. It was just an unbelievable show. I'll go from start to finish, but the opener was a six-man tag with Tama Tonga, Captain New Japan, and Wataru Inoue against Tomohiro Ishii, Yoshihashi, and Jado, where the final thing was Tonga did a guillotine and then dropped down and got the pin on Jado. It was just kind of an opener. I mean, it was okay. Tama Tonga definitely has got something. Fans kind of like him. The thing with him is he's like an imitator. You know, I always write this. Like, when you watch it, you just think it's like he's some guy trying to be Jimmy Snuka. But he imitates Jimmy Snuka, Ric Flair, Bruiser Brody. But it's like everything he does is like an imitation of somebody. But he's a great athlete, and he looks good. And, you know, he did very well in Mexico just on his last tour. Then Jushin Liger, Tiger Mask, Hiromu Takahashi, who's a young guy, against Kushida Bushi and Ryusuke Taguchi, which was a lot short. It was a short match. Taguchi, Bushi pinned, I think it was Takahashi. Bushi pinned Takahashi. They were the last two in. Everybody else was outside with a 450. Which was good, you know. For second match, was good. Then we had the Bob Sapp match, and that match was Aki Bono, Strongman, MVP, and Manabu Nakanishi against Bob Sapp, Yujiro Takahashi, Toriyano, and Takashi Iizuka. And that match wasn't good at all, but it was effective in the sense that it's almost like you go in there with this match that you kind of expect to be bad. It is bad, but it tells a good story, and the stuff is over, and you know, it's got, you know, Bob Sapp and Aki Bono was like a legendary thing in Japan, and so they did that for the first time since the original match. And the TV announcer for New Japan, he was actually kind of like the star of the match. I mean, it's at the last pay-per-view, and really all the time, Iizuka and Yano, especially Iizuka, has been like bullying him. So he came out, and he actually like came to the ring, and he was announcing, you know, while they were doing the ring introductions, and at the end he like got to clothesline Iizuka when Strongman held him, and it was pretty bad. I mean, it was actually kind of a horrible looking clothesline and everything, but it was perversely entertaining. Like, I mean, it was bad. But it wasn't, you know, too bad. Then Masato Tanaka and Shelton Benjamin for the NEVER Championship, which is a title that Tanaka has. The match was short, a lot shorter than I expected. Athletically, it was very good, but I just thought that Yujiro Takahashi was interfering way too much. And the finish of the match actually was Yujiro Takahashi got on the top ropes when Shelton Benjamin had the ankle lock on Tanaka. Yujiro got on the top rope. Shelton Benjamin lets go of the ankle lock, does that jump from the ring to the top rope to the belly-to-belly suplex, superplex spot, and lands. And as soon as he lands, Tanaka comes like kind of sideways and nails him with a sliding D, which is like a sliding low elbow, and pinned him. And it was just kind of like... it was kind of too much of a bullshit finish for a card like this. So, again, like athletically good, but you know, I do have some qualms about the booking in the show. Then tag team title, Lance Archer and Davey Boy Smith Jr. retaining against Carl Anderson and Hirooki Goto. They did the double team power bomb, the killer bomb on Anderson. Then they did it on Goto. Actually, they did it first on Goto, then on Anderson, and then a second one on Goto when they pinned Goto. This was a good match, a very good match, and nice pageantry. They had Archer came out on a motorcycle. Him and Smith both came out wearing masks. They're very effective in this role. I really like... It's Harry Smith has found his calling. This is where he should be. He can be a big foreigner. He can do his wrestling. He fits in really well. He's a good worker. And he's got charisma here, which he never had in the WWE, which I think may have been, you know, there's all kinds of explanations as to why. Maybe he's just figured out or something, but he sure has it here. And Archer too. Archer comes off like a star, and he works like he should work. You know, he works like a big man, like a bully. You know, it's obvious he's watched a lot of tapes of Brody, and he's not Brody, but he's figuring it out. They're good. I mean, they've been good on every pay per view. Yuji Nagata Minoru Suzuki was awesome, psychologically fantastic match. The ring introduction of Minoru Suzuki may have been the highlight of the show. I mean, he's already got the coolest entrance music probably in pro wrestling anyway. And they had, I guess the woman who performs the song was singing it, and she was just awesome. I mean, the thing started out good. It got better. It was tremendous. Nagata won with a bridging back suplex. I'm just watching this. It's like there's nothing in the match. Like in the other matches, there was just like these blowaway spots. This one had no blowaway spots, but they had just the way they worked the match. A little too much head trauma for my taste, but the way they worked the match was just, I was just like in awe of how the match was put together. It was so, from a psychological standpoint, with the exception of the main event, this had it more than in any of the other matches. And then was the Taichi interfered several times in the match as well. Nagata, Nagata's just an awesome worker, and Suzuki for what he does is great. And he had a great match tonight or last night, I guess. Devitt Lowkey and Kota Ibushi ended with Devitt doing the Bloody Sunday DDT off the top rope onto Kota Ibushi. And like I said, this is a match of the year candidate. It's one of the best three-way matches I've ever seen. Maybe the best. Certainly top three, like I said. So much stuff that you don't see coming. So many great moves. Just an awesome, awesome match. I don't know. I mean, it was the best match I've seen since October. Then Muto and Shinjiro Tani against Hiroyoshi Tenzan and Satoshi Kojima. Good match. Almost really good. The only thing I got to say, my main complaint about this match is that Muto can't do a lot. What he does gets over, but he does it over and over. Like, he would do so many dragons. Like, the people just... It's like he's like watching the Rolling Stones, you know what I mean, in the sense that you come to watch them do their songs, you know they're old, you know that they're not what they used to be. I'm thinking that because I just watched the Rolling Stones a couple weeks ago. Not on the pay-per-view, but on that other deal, the December 12th deal. But it's like they give you what you want. And like with this match, the crowd was very into seeing these four guys who were really guys from, a different generation. They're guys from years ago, really, even though, Tenzan and Kojima were, tag team title situation for New Japan and probably will be getting another shot again soon. And they're effective as a team, but they're all past their prime, and Otani's past his prime as well. But they all have these spots that the people want to see. And they got to see all of them, and when they saw them, the people were just very happy. And this match, another thing about this match, the story of this match was originally it was going to be Muto and Daichi Hashimoto, who's Shinya Hashimoto's son. With Daichi Hashimoto making his debut at the Tokyo Dome, which is the building that Shinya Hashimoto sold out probably as many times as anyone, maybe more than anyone. And he would team with Muto, who was, kind of the act, with Kobashi pretty much out of the picture. Muto's the last legend from that era. So when he got hurt, Otani took his place, but it made for a better match in the sense that Otani's a better worker, but the theme was all gone. So what they did was they had Daichi was there, and they opened the match. The first ring announcement was they showed a bunch of clips of Shinya Hashimoto matches, and they played Shinya Hashimoto's music, and the place went crazy, you know, for that. It was just like this feeling of, it kind of made me really sad, because I haven't thought much about Shinya Hashimoto, and he's been dead for many years. And, you know, and he was a big, big star in the 90s who, basically worked, you know, had that Japanese mentality. And I'm not saying that that's what killed him, but that destroyed his body for sure. You know, in the sense that he kept working and working and working, and he needed to save his company. He was dedicated to his company. His shoulder was destroyed. He wouldn't get the surgery because he felt that he didn't want to take the 6 months off, 9 months off, because his company needed him. And he ended up, you know, essentially ruining his career, or ruining his body anyway. And then he ended up dying at the age of 40. But anyway, the match, like I said, the people were into like all of these spots, but then Muto kept doing the Dragon Screw and the Shining Wizard over and over and over to less response each time. To by the time he was on it by his 12th Dragon, not Dragon Screw, but a Shining Wizard, it really, the people weren't really into it anymore, and that actually slightly hurt the match. But aside from that, it was a very good match with Tenzan pinned Otani with a moonsault, and then after the match, Daichi Hashimoto slapped Tenzan in the face, and they were kind of like built tension. So it looks like they're going to go with the Muto and Hashimoto against Tenzan Kojima match, when Hashimoto recovers from his broken arm. And then we had Makabe and Shibata, which I said, just like a fight. That's all I could say. Just a freaking fight. They were both great at what it was. Shibata works completely different from everybody else. He works like he's not cooperating, even though it's a work, kind of like Suzuki used to do. Very effective because he's different from everyone else. Pops up after moves that, you know, you shouldn't do, but for him it works perfectly because he's a shooter. Because then when he finally finally sells, the place goes crazy. I've seen this psychology before with monsters. You don't usually see it with, you know, smaller guys, but it's the monster psychology. I've seen it, you know, when, you know, big man psychology, but, it worked in this match. The only thing is that Makabe won with a knee drop to the back of the head off the top rope. And to me, Shibata should have won this match, because to me, I thought it was almost a given that, you know, Shibata gets a win here and then goes against Tanahashi or Okada for the championship, just because, you know, they've been putting him over strong, and his matches get over, and this match did as well. It made absolutely no sense. They did it in a way where it made sense, because the key spot was Makabe gave him a rabbit lariat on the floor, and he would hit his head on the post. So, you know, shooter or not, you hit your head on the post, you're knocked out, and then, you know, that's, he got beat pretty quickly after that. So it's like, it wasn't like he was, beaten with no qualms, or you can't do a rematch, or he was hurt that bad. They didn't protect him. They did. But he should have won. You know, I mean, this was his time to win. It wasn't Makabe's time to win. Makabe is already over. Makabe can lose, and it doesn't matter, and he'll get a win back another point. I know what the politics are here, you know, in the sense that, you know, the guys in New Japan don't really like the outsiders. This is for real, and they really were not happy that they were brought in. They didn't really want to, you know, this program. It was the owners doing. The booker didn't even want to do it, so they kind of are there to sabotage the program. But here's the thing. I mean, like, sometimes you get these owners, you know, like Inoki or whatever. You get these guys who, they have these ideas. They don't, you know, they're out of the box, and they don't work, and they just flop. This one was out of the box, and it worked. I mean, every show, the Shibata and Sakuraba match always got over great. So it's like, it's working with the audience. It's like, I know you don't want it. I know you were against it when it started, but when it's working, you know, go with it. And I think that this was, Gedo and Jado are, you know, they're probably the best bookers in the business over the last couple of years. But this one, it was you know, that the thing you always see where it's like, I don't want this one, and I didn't believe in this one, and it wasn't my idea, and so you don't go all the way with it. But this one they should have gone all the way with. And then you had Sakuraba and Nakamura, which was, like I said, just Nakamura ended up winning the match with a knee, and then just a couple of sick knees in there. But there were spots in this match that just blew me away. And then Tanahashi Okada went 34 minutes of an absolutely fantastic match. It was comparable. Maybe, you know what? I think it may have been, they had three matches. I think it may have been the best of the three. It was not as, I don't think it was as good as Okada's match with Naito, the first one. Maybe as good as the second one. Not as good as Tanahashi's match with Suzuki, but that was a completely different style of match, so it's hard to compare. For a Tanahashi-Okada match at the Tokyo Dome, the match was perfect. It was everything it should have been, exactly what it should have been, other than you can argue the finish. But there may be, again, if there's any danger of Okada going to the WWE, because I know WWE wants him, then that was the right finish. If not, if there is no danger, as great as Tanahashi has been as a champion, and he's been the best champion in the sport for the last 2 years, and I know, like when business is good and all this, and business was good here, this show was a huge, huge success. They said they had 29,000 paid, which would be the largest paid attendance that they've had in years. So it's like I get the idea that when business is good, you don't change. But I just think it was time. There's especially with Shibata not winning, there's really no new match for Tanahashi. With Okada, you got a bunch of new matches. I mean, Naito, you could do Tanahashi and Naito, you could do, but Naito's not going to be back for months. You can do Tanahashi, and there's opponents. You can do Nagata, who won on this show. You could do Goto. Well, Goto lost on this show, though, so I probably wouldn't do Goto. I know you could do Carl. I know that Tanahashi wants to defend against Carl Anderson, which would be a great match. And you've got... there's always outsiders, and like I said, there's guys, Makabe and Nagata, but to me, there's no big match coming out of this. I guess you could always go back to Nakamura, I suppose. So I guess there's some, but anyway, I would be very surprised if this is not the card of the year. And if it is not, somebody's putting on one hell of a show this year, because this show was fantastic. So anyway, you got to see it, Brian, and talk about it over the weekend.
I will probably watch it tomorrow.
Yeah, you can skip the first.
I kind of want to watch Bob Sapp.
Yeah, well, okay. I mean, the first two matches you can skip. The Sapp match, then the what's the match after that? The next match after the Sapp match is the Tanaka and Benjamin, which, again, it's not a great match, but I wouldn't skip it. The match is all right. So, yeah, it's a long day. You got to get in a soundproof room and not do what I did, which is answer phone calls all the way through.
Oh.
But you really should just watch it all the way through. I mean, it's a long freaking show. It's 4.5 hours. I mean, you got to set time. It's like watching a UFC, I guess, long show. But this one is... It's awesome. That's all I could say. It's better than any UFC.
So it's available on Ustream, everybody, through January 11th. So you've got quite a bit of time. I think, was it $34.99, $29.99? What was
$35.
It? $35.
$35, yeah.
$35. But based on feedback, you're ripping off New Japan by only paying $35. That's...
If I pay $55 for WWE and UFC, this is worth a lot more than that. I mean, this is a blow away show. I mean, I was just like, in the last several matches, I was just in awe of really a good five matches on the show. Just absolutely in awe of how good these guys were and how well they worked, and how, you know, again, every match is different. That's what makes it so great. It's like, it's, you know, you can see a show with a bunch of matches that are, you know, four-star matches, but they're, you know, after a while, you know, it's like, yeah, they're great, and they even get over, but, you know, like three straight hours of seeing the same thing, sometimes this is not that. I mean, it's not like it's WWE style where, you know, they have a certain thing and all that. I mean, this is, everyone's doing something different. So, it's, you know, if you look at the feedback on the front page, I mean, you know, you're going in there with the bar set high, but believe me, it delivers.